Record, ja, oké, zo ja. Ja, staat nu aan. Ik wist niet hoe ik aan moest zetten.
So, as I was saying, I just want to go quickly over the process of incarnation. Because one of the big reasons for our differences is actually that we all have walked a different path to get to where we are now. In the conversation I'll be talking about both soul and spirit, the mind. I just want to have it clear of what I mean with it in this context. So with the soul, I mean the eternal part of our being. So the soul is the part of us which always exists, which can never die, and which can just take new and new forms again and again. Our spirit is the part of us which actually goes into manifestation. So the part of our soul which travels to the towards the physical world to inhabit various bodies. The mind is actually a smaller fragment of the spirit. It's the conscious part of ourselves, because the spirit encompasses a lot more than our consciousness can comprehend. And well, then of course we have our bodies. The body dies, and also the larger part of the mind just dies as soon as you leave the body, but the spirit remains. And the spirit actually takes with it some of the knowledge and experiences of the mind. So if, for instance, in a previous life you were, you had a certain theme to your life, you wanted to be a healer or a warrior, then the spirit will accept all your experiences, your knowledge, your wisdom on this subject, and will take it with it to your next life. So we have, in a way, an arsenal of talents which we brought from our previous lives, but we also have possible problems which we brought from those lives. Because it can also be that in a certain life things did not go as planned, and you were disappointed, you were hurt, and you started to overcompensate. And this behavior, and you can also bring into a next incarnation. I want to give a little example here to make it a bit more clear. I had a client who had really a big problem with defending herself. So her energy system was very, very open, very weak. So we had a look at her previous incarnations, and then we found out that during one incarnation she was murdered, and before she was murdered she was tortured. And this led actually to this pattern of, well, a very deep fear, a very deep anxiety of like, the world is very hostile, it's very dangerous, so the only way I won't get murdered or killed is by being very compliant. I'll just do whatever other people want me to do. I won't be a threat to anybody. I won't stand up for myself, and at least I will survive. So this trauma can actually lead to things which are ununderstandable if you just focus on this life. It's why I feel like this. Why don't I stand up for myself? So this is a very important factor. It's a factor which always also comes back, so often experiences in our previous incarnations are relived during our childhood. Then we get another chance to do things differently. What's also very important is that the spirit is not actually connected to any culture or time. And every time it re-enters the earth, it makes an astrological connection. So the planets, they move, the earth consciousness moves, the consciousness of also societies and countries changes. So there's a kind of an energy field, a sea of energy, in which the spirit lands, and it is from this energy that it actually creates an energetic body. So depending upon the country where you're born or the constellation of the planets, you have various energies or forces at your disposal. And depending on the skill of the spirit in handling the available energies, you have more or less control over this energy body. So, for instance, there's various planets. There's Mars. Mars is the planet of masculine energy. It's also the planet of war, but also of manifestation. And if your spirit doesn't have a strong connection with Mars, or a little understanding of this aspect of its energetic body, and this is going to remain a very subconscious, a very not very well developed part of your being. So one of the important things is also to regard what powers are strong in me, because these are your tools, and it doesn't really matter which planet is strong in you. It's a tool which you can use to stabilize yourself and to deal with the problems. Mars is very much the warrior, but you can also use your consciousness to transform problems. That would be more of a sun energy, where you can just go into a process of transformation, of change, using the moon energies. But as I said, every talent is every person has different talents in this. Allow the spirit to fulfill its purpose in its incarnation, it creates various structures. So the spirit has a dual purpose. One purpose is to transform itself, to grow. And the other purpose is actually to manifest itself in the world. We are not really singular beings. We're born in a Western society where there's a lot of individuality. You'll think, okay, I'm this person, I have my own goals. But spiritually speaking, we're all part of a bigger family, a bigger flow. So people you have a shared purpose with or shared vision with, you're going to re-encounter them in all your incarnations. So you're actually doing more of a group travel than an individual travel. And within this group, there are also various roles, because every group has a certain dream, of an ideal of a better world, or a path of liberation or growth. And some persons feel, I want to be a healer, I want to make whole what is disrupted. Other persons are more protectors or teachers. And depending on the role you feel, and also the balance, like how much should I do for myself and how much should I do for others, you'll choose a different path in your life. These people you know from previous lives are also your most important support in your incarnation, because they can help you to remember, why am I here, what am I doing here, what is my purpose. And you can feel that by just being yourself, you are nurturing and supporting to them, and they are nurturing and supporting to you, because you already made a deal or a compact to help each other out. And during your life, you're just actually remembering what you already agreed on as a spirit. To cope with the life on our plane of existence, we create several mechanisms, and one of the most known and popular mechanisms is the ego. The spirit comes from a different reality, a higher plane of consciousness, and it goes into a foreign country, if you will. So it doesn't speak the language, it doesn't understand why things are happening in the way they are. So within the mind, which is the tool of the spirit to be down here, it starts to create an image of itself and its situation. So you create a little cosmos in you where you say, I'm going to create a little internal representation of all the people and of all the forces, all the things around you. So you have this little theater in your head, and you have an idea of what the role is, or what the play is, and what your role is in this world. So, and there you get an identification with your life and your purpose in this life. So, for instance, you may have a job as a baker, and you come from a certain town, and, well, who are you? Well, I'm a baker, and I'm from Breda. And this is who you are, because it's not who your spirit is, but it is who your incarnation is. And it's on the one hand necessary, because you have to live here, you have to be here, you have to know how to act and how to perform. But the ego can get into, go divergence with the spirit, so that you can get a conflict of interest. The spirit wants to go one way and the ego wants to go another way. And this is actually the most weakening thing which can happen to your energy structure. Because the spirit draws in the higher energies, and the ego draws in the lower energies. So the part of you which realizes it is down here, it will connect to whatever energies are around you. So from the ego, you will say like, okay, well, there's metal, there's stones, there's animals, there's plants. Yeah, there's lots of things which can give me strength or stability and provide me with what I need. But the higher part of you is what provides you with a purpose. It tells you, why am I here? What do I want to do with my life? And it works not so much from this perspective of like the singular self who tries to survive in the world. It's much more oriented towards love and cooperation, sharing. And these two have to be in balance to have a good defense. If the spirit is too weak compared to the ego structure, then the ego structure will be misguided into doing what is good for the incarnation and lose its way. So it's very easily misguided, so it can easily be deluded by being given false ideals. So it can be told, well, this is good for you, or this will help you, or you have to think of your future, and be taken away into directions which are not healthy for you. And the reverse is also true. If, like, the spirit is very dominant, but the ego is still weak, you feel that you do not understand the world around you, and also the energies in the world are very hard, low, tough energies, and the spirit has more subtle energies, so it's easily deformed. It cannot go through them anymore. So you need some heavy energy to stabilize yourself, to have a bit of a counterforce against the things which are working upon you. The problematic thing for us humans is that actually our consciousness is relatively small compared to our complexity.
What is small, this?
Our consciousness.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, we actually have a lot of structures, of parts, of programs. Some of the best known structures are the chakras, which are also used in the meditation. So we have lots of little centers, which are all automatically trying to follow their own programming. It's like breathing and letting your heart breathe. So consciousness can't deal with all these things, so it just automates a lot of what's going on. The problem is that, we continue in life, we grow and our situation changes, but our programming is not always updated. So, and also not all the programming is developed up to a level that it should be. So there's always the challenge to be well adapted to your surroundings. This adaptation process is what we'll also be looking at a lot more deeply, because the larger part of our being, roughly 80% of also our energy bodies, are actually subconscious for us. So the part which we do not know is larger than the part which we do know of ourselves. And by working and doing meditation. It's a little bit like being in a dark room with a flashlight. So you can, with the meditation, you can focus your attention or your consciousness on this chakra or that chakra. So you stand in this dark room and with your flashlight, you can see all the things which are in the room. So you can see and become aware of all the parts of yourself. But it's not possible for our human consciousness to be aware of our whole being.
I heard last time it is 80% unconsciousness, unconscious,
yes.
Like that.
Yes, yeah. What did I say it wrong?
Huh?
Did I say it wrong?
No, 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 but you said it's...
You're conscious enough to...
Yes, okay.
You said it's bigger, but I heard it's 80%. So. Yeah.
And you also said 80%.
Yeah, yes.
Oh, yeah, I didn't hear it. Okay. Forget it. don't hear everything.
So one of the problems is also that we create a system which also protects us against ourselves. This is where we get into a lot of trouble. For instance, I fall in love. The love is not mutual. So my heart gets hurt, I suffer pain, and this adaptation mechanism in me is going to tell me, well, pain is not good, pain is very bad, so you know what, let's fix this. This whole love thing, it's that's not good for me, I'll just wall it off, and well, next time, a nice lady comes along, well, I won't open up as much anymore. And these... Yeah, automated defense mechanisms, so they can defend you against things which you actually need. So you actually, become very unbalanced. But the opposite can also happen. For instance, you grow up and your parents or your friends are rather abusive to you, and you just know, well, if I need to have some contact with the people around me, and well, it is in this way that people react to me. They're kind of hard or tough on me, or they make fun of me, but well, okay, that's okay, at least I'm getting some attention, I'm not getting totally neglected. And you just get used to being fed and nurtured in this way, and you allow these energies to come in, and you do not resist them. So the first thing you need to find out to build a better defense for yourself, to find out, like, okay, why am I giving away energies, or why am I allowing negative energies to come in? Because there's generally a part of you which is okay with that. And usually this part is a subconscious part, because the subconscious is the larger part of our being. So it's also the stronger magnet to draw events or people into our lives. Some of you may have heard of like The Secret, where you try to focus your thoughts and your energies on achieving something. Yes, it's a powerful technique to focus your energy, and by creating it inside of you, you will also, like to the magnets, you will also attract it outside of you. Since the larger part of you is subconscious, there may be a very different voice attracting things which your conscious mind does not want or does not like. And the important thing also is to try to see clearly that some of the things which our ego might not like might be things which our ego, which our spirit does like. So we also have these two influences drawing energies towards us. And the ego is usually trying to stabilize things. It's about survival. So any change or any different energy, so the ego is always striving for more stability, more power as well. But this can also be a trap, because you don't adjust, you don't change, you don't grow. And if the situation around you changes, then you get stuck in the past. And often the ego, since it's a survival mechanism, the first tool of the ego is to use repression. So, well, I don't want to think this, I don't want to feel this, I don't want to deal with this. So it tends to shove things into the subconscious. And the consciousness is also what allows us to transform patterns. So And if things remain subconscious, there will be no growth. And to counter this process of compassion, the spirit often tries to attract the very things that we are afraid of, the very things we have locked away in the darkest recesses of our minds. Because, well, if we are afraid of something and we don't think about it and we push it away, then it's never going to transform. And the spirit has a strong desire to grow, to transform, so it will open itself up to be, well, as the ego would put it, traumatized again. So now I want to do some, first of all, I'll say one more thing, and then we'll do some practices. The tools of both the ego and the spirit are the aura and the chakras. It's actually by these automatic systems that we attract or open up to certain energies. And the ego itself does not nurture the chakras, but the spirit does. So often you will find that if the power of the spirit is more present or more dominant, stronger in the body, that the chakras will function a lot more strongly. So you will be able to create a stronger defense and to attract more strongly the events which you need and to keep away the energies which you don't need. The ego can control the chakras, but it does not feed them. So if a person has a very strong ego, you will notice that there's a very big rigidity in the inner chakras, but not a lot of flexibility in the chakras, not a lot of flow of energy.
Rigidity.
It's very rigid, very not
tight.
Inflexible. Mm-hmm.
And you said to help the unconscious become conscious, the spirit does what?
It attracts often the very things you've pushed away. So for instance, if in your childhood you were beaten up and you've pushed that away and I don't want to deal with it, that my parents did not love me, then you end up in a relationship that could beat it up. Because you have not really transformed that part of your being. It's relatively easy if it's an event in your life, but it can also be events in previous incarnations, which are also unconscious, which you start reliving in this life or recreating in this life. We're quite fortunate that we live now in a society which is not quite as violent as previous societies were. So often you will find that things come back in a slightly diluted, weaker form just to make you aware of something. In dealing with the events, it's essential to have the right attitude. So on the one hand, your ego needs to grow, your ability to deal with things, to defend yourself needs to grow, but also your ability to transform yourself needs to go hand in hand. Because in every situation, you have the choice. You can either change yourself, or you can change the situation. And if you change yourself, then you grow, you become better. But also you allow the situation to have a certain influence over you. You can also do the opposite and say, well, I'm not going to change, the situation will have to change. I'm going to resist this power which is trying to force a change in me. So with every force which comes towards you, it's important to try to realize, is this a positive thing? Does my spirit invite this into my life as a chance for growth in my awareness? Or is this actually a blockage, a disruption of my life path? And then, you will need to use your ego forces more to block this disruption and not to allow to upset the path of your spirit. But it's always a tricky thing to find out which is which. Okay. The the chakras themselves. They can also be, so they're under control, both the spirit and the ego. But the chakras themselves also have positive and negative sides, because the chakra tries to encompass the totality of energy. And we are, by our nature, dualistic beings, and by making a choice to do one thing, we're choosing not to do something else. And this can also generate a tension within the chakra itself. So every chakra has actually two faces, if you will. And it's always important not to spend too much energy fighting yourself, because there's always the double tendency in yourself. So for the throat chakra, for instance, like one tendency is to show itself, to share its knowledge, to open up, and the other is the opposite. It's to wear a mask, to hide behind appearances, to deceive, and to create a little smoke screen and the charades. And if there's like a lot of internal fight within this chakra, then it becomes uncontrollable for like the ego and the spirit. So then this internal battle has to be resolved, and the chakra has to accept the authority of the spirit, of the conscious mind, to guide it. In Indian philosophy, it's often compared also to that you have all these powers and urges and programmings which come with the body. And they try to, they're a little bit like wild horses, so they just gallop off in this direction or the other. And it is the challenge of the mind to grab the reins and control them and to make them go where you want to go. So it's very much controlling yourself. So they need it to be able to control the interaction. Well, it's a little bit of a complex story, so I need to pause a little and give everybody a few minutes just to digest it and see if any questions come up. Various ways to look at it. One of them, like if you want to look at the nature of your energy body, you can just start to study it by just looking at the structure of the energy body. So some people have an energy body which is very, very tough, very inflexible, very solid. So their nature is not to be very sensitive, and often their function is also to be a stabilizing force, a fighter. And other people have a very open energy structure. This open energy structure can be in two ways. One structure is open in that it allows other energies to come in. So you become a channel for other beings or energies to move through you. So they don't have a manifestation in themselves, but through you they can manifest themselves, so they're in a way a manifester, in a mystical sense. Some people use it in a more magical way, so they more call up energies and allow them to move through you. So this is going towards the magical. Other people, they have actually incarnated through a certain power source in themselves, which they try to manifest, so they're not so much a channel, but they're an incarnation of an energy. And all these structures have different purposes. We have also people with an energy structure which is more like a chameleon. It actually copies the other structures that comes into contact with. And with such a structure, a person would be best suited as a reader, as a mirror.
Thank you.
the fields where we're working can be determined by looking a little bit at the at the elemental energies. So some people have a lot of earth, others a lot of water, air or fire energies. Earth energy is often the most manifest energy. It's often about organizing something, creating something, also in a physical sense, like an artist does. Water is much more about the emotion, but also about memory, reliving things. Air is about thought, so much more about structuring. And fire is more about inspiration, so being sensitive to higher energies and then allowing them to manifest themselves, to create a certain emotion, and also to break free from patterns. We all have all four energies, but they're in a different mix. And often the strongest energies often indicate the areas where you will be most, where it would be most useful to manifest yourself, or to put your energy.
And is it showing you the nature of the energetic body or the nature of people?
It's of the energetic body, yeah. And then there's also the way in which you do it.
Mm-hmm.
Because even if you have, for instance, if you look at it, a person might have brought the energy down, and they have a strong earth energy, but well, that still doesn't show you what to do with it.
Oh yeah.
And people have a structure called the cocoon in the aura. And the cocoon shows you whether you're a person who's also into in a supportive role or in a critical role or a creative or more structuring role. So there's actually a whole a network of energies which you're a part of. And becoming aware of your energetic connections is also the very important step to becoming aware of what your purpose is in life. And this is actually a bottom-up thing, so you look at what you have and you try to understand, okay, why do I have this? Also, the dreams you have in your childhood are often a good indication, because as a child the ego is not so strong, the spirit is. So the spirit is aware of what it wants to do. So often those childhood dreams show you your power. In certain cultures, it's also usual for a spiritual person to give a name, or even with an initiation to give a new name, to make a person aware of their purpose in life, their path in life. So this can also be a way to find out. If you want to look at it from the opposite side, you can do a meditation where you do a reverse incarnation process. So you allow your consciousness to go into your spirit, and the spirit to leave your body, and then the spirit leaves the earth. So it really detaches itself from the current time and place, which are all ego energies. And by going back into this spirit state, you can also remember, I know who I am now, but I'm consciously going back towards the body. You can see how your purpose is trying to manifest itself. Recognize to maybe practice this a little.
You distinguished changing yourself from changing the situation, but somehow I feel that when you change yourself, you change the situation.
But it's also where your focus is, because if you change yourself, then you won't need certain lessons, and certain things will just disappear or appear, because you need them to continue. So in this way, you're actually using indeed the your inner world to have an effect on the outer world. But your focus is really to change your inner world, to grow. Mm-hmm. But other people have a reverse focus, so they're not changing their inner world, they're very rigid, so they have this ideal, which may be a political ideal or a spiritual ideal, mm-hmm. and they feel that everything should be fit in this shape and this form. So that's more of a dogmatic point of view.
Yeah.
And this dogmatic point of view does not nurture your spirit, but it does feed very much the ability to fight against other forces.
Yeah.
It's more of your, the less flexible you are, the less flexible often the opponent is, you get much more friction.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But there are people who prefer, who learn by friction, and there's people who learn by openness. This can be, these are different parts of the spirit. And there's also people who learn by letting go. By saying, like, okay, well, it doesn't matter what he wants or what I want, it's about what God wants. So, you go into a very different perspective. And that's also indeed a very important thing, to understand your own perspective. And whether you indeed need the challenge, or if you need more of the unity. Because people who learn by, for instance, say, like, okay, well, I want to be like this holy person or guru, and they will open up to the guru and try to absorb some of this energy to become more like them. And this is growing in a unity, in a flow of energy. But other people have the opposite, and they will say, like, okay, well, this person stands for everything I'm against, so I will fight him, and thereby you will also turn yourself into something else.
I recognize actually both of those energies.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, we have all these mechanisms, but often in the person, one or the other will be a dominant mechanism.
So actually the clue thing is to decide what I want, what experience I want in this life.
Yes. Then often the but even if you know it can be a difficult thing.
Oh really?
Focus.
In one instance I had a person come for a reading, and she said, well, I don't know what to do with myself, and I want you to tell me what I would be good at. I told her, you have a very strong sensitivity, you're very motivated by the needs of others, and you would be very good in a supportive role, and in a caring role, you have a good intuition. And this person got, a little bit upset, because, that's what she had been doing for the past 15 years, and she wants to change. Yes. But the thing is also that we're actually stuck with the choices which our spirit made for us. And it can be quite challenging for our minds to understand. I'm also in contact with the mystery school, and they have a very beautiful legend there of some people who came from a very high state of consciousness and came to the earth to help. But as soon as they came down, they got into this body, and they saw all these interesting things around them, and they got like really distracted, and they forgot their purpose. And after enjoying themselves with all the technology and things, they found that their lives were empty, so they committed suicide. Their life had no purpose, because they had lost contact with their spirit. But as soon as they committed suicide, they remembered what they were about to do, so they had to incarnate again. And this is a very big challenge for our spirits to be here, and also to be remembered.
What is that, a mystery school?
It's basically a place where they recreate a lot of the big themes in the cosmos. So actually, all the forces in the universe, they try to represent them somehow in plays and in stories. So everybody is in a way of acting out a role or representing certain forces, and by observing yourself and observing the interaction between people, you can understand more. That seems to be the way they trained the priesthood in ancient Egypt. So the priests and priestesses had to understand what the universe was about. So they would be in these groups for a few years to gain deeper understanding. And this is one of the beautiful stories which helps you to understand the process and how, like if the spirit cannot do what it wants, depression sets in. It's so challenging. Okay. Are there any more questions? Okay. Well, then I think it might be nice to do a little self-observation experiment. So first we're going to have a little look at some of our chakras. Because, as I said, like these chakras themselves, they can become deregulated or can get a lot of their own old programs. So these chakras always have two faces. As I said about the throat chakra, it can be on the one hand the negotiator, which is working for you, and you try to get things done, or you try to get things across. So, in a positive way, it's acting in your best interest and says, there is an internal desire, and I need to bring it out in such a way that it will be fulfilled. In a negative way, it's actually stops working for you and starts working for the environment. So it can get programmed to basically say, my parents and society and my teachers and the guru, they all say that this is good and this is the way I should be, and then it turns into a critic. So instead of helping you to influence the world is actually influencing you. And it can have a purpose in that you change and you adapt yourself, but in a negative sense it can be like a straitjacket of I have to do this, I have to be like this. I can't say that to my teacher or to my parent, or it won't be accepted by society. And every chakra has these two sides. So if you look at the third eye, the chakra in the forehead helps you to actually become aware of all the other chakras. So in its most positive sense, it's actually the king, the wise king who listens to all the subjects and the desires of his people and decides what to do and who should perform what task. And in the negative sense, there's the sixth chakra of the dictator, and the tyrant, who has a certain vision of what you should be like. You see this often also within religion, I can't think negative thoughts, I have to be celibate, and in a way, instead of listening to all the other chakras, it starts to become a tyrant and represses all the other chakras. It says, I can't feel that, I can't desire that, I can't do that. So it becomes very much a blocking force. It's interesting to observe. The heart chakra is about connection. So the heart chakra, in its positive sense, allows us to feel what other people are feeling, allows us to identify with other beings. It doesn't matter whether humans or animals or plants or spirits. So it actually opens up our world, it makes it wider. In a negative sense, it can get very enamored with a certain sensation, I like to feel excited, or I like to feel stimulated, so I want to do dangerous things, or I want to eat nice food, or and this enamoration with certain emotions can be very strong. So I want this person to give me lots of attention, to call me every day, to send me 13 SMSs every day. So the heart can get a little bit twisted in this way as well. The third chakra is actually the part of us which allows us to manifest ourselves, to manifest our energies, to show who we are in action. And so it's in a way, in a positive way, also the warrior who protects us and to gives us strength.
The third is your heart?
No, the third is the
soul.
In a positive way, it's the warrior, which protects us, but also serves us. But it's also the chakra where our ego is often very strong. So this is also very much the identification with who we are, with our body, with our purpose. So the third chakra can also become very, very rigid in how it is. So then it's not so much the warrior, but more the jailer, the prison keeper. So it keeps us in a certain form. It only allows us to act in a certain way, because otherwise you won't succeed, you won't be successful. So you can get a very strong program in there, which reduces your flexibility. The second chakra is about, in a way, the hunter. The part of you which feels that you need to grow to stimulate yourself. So in a positive way, it gathers the energies and the experiences which you need. In a negative sense, it can get trapped in gathering things which actually guide you in the wrong direction. So, for instance, addictions. Addiction is also very much a second chakra energy, because it feels good, feels nice, and the second chakra will say, like, okay, well, this is a good thing for me. And
ouch, called me. Clink the energy.
Look painful.
Look painful.
So in the negative sense, it's in a way the glutton. You can't have enough of something. And all these forces, they exist in a balance. There is a delicate balance. Because if the force is controlled, for instance, the second chakra, if it is controlled by the spirit, then the spirit will try to attract experiences, food, energies, which are nurturing. If it's controlled by the ego, it will start to gather energies which are empowering. So you will go often for energies which make you feel more stable, make you feel more strong. So you will still gather energies. But if it's like uncontrolled, then it can be very chaotic, and then you can often go into, like, for instance, addiction. But and this is true for every chakra. So it's important, if we do the chakra meditation, chakra exercise, to try to find out, like, again, which voice is strongest in the chakra. Is it like listening more to my ego? Is it listening more to my spirit? Is there a good, or is there a good balance? And also with every chakra, to try to find out how much tension is there. Is it going its own way? Is there a lot of old programming just running on automatic? It can be out of control as well. The way to change things is just very simple, through consciousness. Because we, as conscious beings, we have the authority to reprogram ourselves, to reroute our own instructions. And it's very important also to be gentle with ourselves. Because if we go into this role of the tyrant, and we say, like, well, you can't want that, that's bad for me, and you try to force your chakra to be different, and it will just lead to a loss of contact. So the chakra will go more into your subconscious, you become less aware of what the chakra is and what it is doing. it's very important to have a process of integration, that you become more one with all these different energy centers.
And how can you do this?
Yeah, by your consciousness, but also by your intention. By being very gentle with also your own negative things. So if you feel like, oh gosh, there's this really self-destructive part of me, that you say, okay, well, that's a part of me. It's part of of my spirit or a part of my ego, and that's okay. But I have to see, like, why is it here? Listen to it. What does it want to do? Where do you think it will? Where will it take me? And is it still necessary? So just to, not to act out of hostility, but more as a, as a king, as a wise king, listening to all the various subjects. They all have different voices, all have different goals. And using your wisdom of your consciousness, you have to decide, okay, well, what shall we do about it? And try to get the people to live in peace, even though they won't always get their way. Okay. So, then we'll start. And I think it would be nice to just go a little bit, with two chakras at a time, and then have a little discussion of what people are noticing or what people are feeling.
Maybe before we do that, we unpack about the chakras from Papa and Chandra, because I missed part of the theme.
Okay.
And not all of us are so aware of all the chakras.
So there's lots of different chakra systems, but I'm now using the Indian system, which is comprised of seven chakras, and I'm just going to talk about them in rising order. This is also how they developed as we grow older. The first chakra is actually the place of the connection, where our spirit connects to our bodies. So the first chakra holds actually our programming, our also the knowledge and the energies which we bring from our previous incarnations. So the first chakra is really a very big energy source for the rest of our energy body. It's usually not in a bad condition, only if the spirit is somehow very discontent with the way our lives are going. Or if it doesn't feel at home in its body. And it's the situation the body is in. The second chakra is the chakra of the desires, because the spirit comes here and then it wants to grow, it wants to develop, it wants to manifest itself. So in the second chakra you get all the different desires for all the different energies and experiences. And the second chakra is over here, just below the navel. The third chakra is at the stomach level. And the third chakra is about manifesting itself, because having a desire is one thing, but you also have to act to fulfill those desires. And that's actually where the third chakra comes in. It gives us the power of action, the power of manifestation. So this is actually also where the seat of the ego is, because that's the part which is helping us to manifest. But in this state, the ego is still pretty connected to our spirit. But in the higher chakras, you often notice that the ego starts drifting away in purpose more. Then we have the heart chakra. And the heart chakra is where we make the connection to the outside world. So the first three chakras, you're really a very egocentric person. You're focused on your own desire, your own will, what do you want. And in the heart chakra, you start to become aware of your own feelings, but also the feelings of others. And then the fifth chakra, it's at the throat. You try to balance your own desires and the desires of others. And this is in shamanism also called the lie chakra and the mask chakra, because often you find that, like, if you look at the bottom four chakras, there's just one impulse, like, okay, you want something, there's a desire and there's an emotion, and then when it comes to, well, what did you say or what do you express, then it often comes out very differently. This is why they call it the light chakra. Because we're suddenly confronted not so much with just our own feelings and force, but also with society and our knowledge about society, what's proper and what's expected of us, is also in the throat chakra. Very much the balance between the desires of others and yourself. That's going to be most of society. It's a difficult chakra for many people. Then we have the sixth chakra, it's on the forehead. And this chakra helps us to gain understanding, to gain insight. So it's really the chakra of awareness of all the other energies and how to find to create a kind of an internal model. So your sense of reality is actually in the third eye. And the seventh chakra is how we receive guidance from the higher world. Because even though we incarnated here, we still have our links and our spiritual friends, which are still in higher planes of consciousness. And even though we might have forgotten who we are, they still know, and they try to guide us by inspiring us by giving us dreams. So this is a very intuitive chakra. Often the energies which come in through a lot of other chakras, you become aware of them in the heart. So the heart is actually also, like the four chakras, really in the center of all the other chakras. So that's the place also where we're able to feel, to notice what's going on the most accurately, because it's very helpful to connect. So, I want to start now with a little meditation on the second and the third chakra. Make yourself comfortable. Talking a lot, and just focus your attention on your heart. So now it's not so much about listening or knowing, it'll be more about becoming aware of what is there. You can envision that you're sitting outside and it is night. There's darkness all around you. So we are going now into our own subconscious, a place where there is no light. But first feel, how does this darkness feel for you? You feel threatened by your own subconscious. You feel at peace with it. So the reaction you're feeling is the reaction of your ego. So it tells you something of the relationship between your ego and your subconsciousness. Are they enemies? Are they friends? And often there's a difficult relationship, because the ego is about control and the subconscious cannot be controlled, cannot be seen. Just allow yourself to be in the darkness. you see a light in the distance, a little campfire. Consciousness starts breaking through. Feel what that does to you. You're afraid of the light. You're drawn to it. Is it your friend or is it blinding you? Try to find the right place, the balance between light and shadow. Are you not blinded? You can still feel the darkness, but not swallowed by it. Take some time to experiment with how aware or how relaxed you can be. To combine it, to be aware and yet relax. Imagine that you are now sitting down close to the campfire. Now on this edge of consciousness and subconsciousness. In the twilight, I'm going to invite our second chakra to come, our hunter, our gatherer. You will notice that it's not one person, but actually many. So you will notice that some of them will sit next to you on your side, and others will sit on the opposite side. Just look. How many people are on your side? How many are on the other side? This shows you a little bit the distribution, how much you agree with yourself. Turn towards the people on your side. Ask them why they are happy. Why are they with you? And feel their joy, feel their happiness, how your life is going. Turn towards the people on the other side of the fire. Ask them why they are there. What it is that you are not giving yourself. And why not? And it's possible that you can feel a little bit of emotion coming up. pain, fear, resentment. Just allow that to be. Just listen to the emotions which are there. See what you can do to maybe get some of the people on the other side on your side. Ask them what you need to change in your life, in yourself. Try to feel in your body how as the people shift to your side, how the chakra changes in your body. Now you invite the people of your third chakra to join you. Ask these warriors to come and sit around the campfire. And try to see how many of them are working for your spirit. Working for your mind, for your ego. And that balance will also show you how much you is dedicated to transforming yourself or to transforming the world around you. Ask the warriors on your side why they are with you, why they are happy. The warriors on the other side, why they are there, why they are not with you. See if you can get them to come to your side. invite them to stay close to the line so they can show themselves to you. They feel like. And while remaining aware, these parts of your body go back to your normal waking consciousness. Come back to this world.